a perfect Friday afternoon, the job was almost done. The house we were decorating was owned by a little old man, always in the same three-piece suit he'd probably had since he was demobbed. He seemed to be forever on his way to the post office, carrying brown paper and string-wrapped parcels under his arm. He'd bring us out china cups of camp coffee and plates of custard cream biscuits. The house had belonged to his parents, who had both passed away within weeks of each other a few years back. They were the only people he'd ever lived with. This was the only house he'd ever lived in. I wondered what would happen to the house when he's gone. It was a short walk to my bedsit, once a similar house to the old man's, now broken into lots of single room accommodation. It also once had a great garden like his, now occupied by a one-story modern block building containing a dentist and chiropodist. In my room was an electric cooker, which I only used in winter to keep warm. Next to that was a sink with a glass shelf above it, on which was a toothbrush and a Carlton of Marlboroughs. There was a table with a chair in one corner, a single bed in the other, and about 4 square feet in the middle. There was a wooden drawer under the bed with most of my clothes in, the rest were hung on the back of the chair. I had a record player on the table and boxes of records underneath. The bathroom for the first and second floor was opposite my room. It had a meter for the water which took 2 50-pence pieces. You'd have to wait half an hour for the water to heat up and keep an eye on the door in case some sod pinched your bath. There was one toilet upstairs and one outside. Nobody used the outside one anymore, so it was somewhere the local prostitutes would take their clients for a quickie. I'd spend as little time as I could in my room. My skin was still warm and soft from the bath as I walked into town.
Just get hung up about George Lazenby. She smoked.
She lived by the river, the other side of town. Queue for taxis was hell as usual. Next to the late night chippy, the worst chip she could buy, but at this time of night, full. Outside, fights were thrown up. We jumped in the taxi, nothing mattered but us. Back at hers, a bedsit in a house similar to mine. She'd done something, painted three walls, put up some old 50s Star Wars paper, a big Bowie poster and some nice curtains. It would be easy for me to change my wood chip Magnolia bedsit standard. After all, it was my job. She had a few lamps here and there and some candles. She made us proper hot chocolate, not the instant shit you get from a machine. She had Fox's biscuits and a small bottle of Cointreau too. The end of a perfect day. The taste of chocolate, cigarettes and orange liqueur made her lips even better. I undid a tartan miniskirt, pulled off her black wool tights. My lips moved up her legs. What the fuck? I had a large, hard dick poking me in the eye. Shit, you're a chap. I felt like jumping through the window screaming. I couldn't move. He still looked the same. I had a pain in my head. I wanted to do something, say something. He was holding me, sobbing. He must have known. How could you not tell? And I love you. I can be your woman. His eyes were still beautiful, deep brown. His lips still chocolatey and orangey. Shit, I said. I was never a breast man anyway.